Now, from their point of view, they got all excited because in this passage, as we get on to the book of Acts in chapter 1, they ask the question, will you at this time restore your kingdom to Israel? In fact, they don't even say it that way. The pure translation is this question. Master, will you at this time restore our kingdom? That's what it really says in Greek. Do you get their perspective? Their perspective is, and likely so, they are not thinking eternal. They are thinking historical and they are thinking temporal. What they were really saying, to put it in modern context, is, Lord, will you now restore us as a sovereign state? Now, Jesus could have said, no, that's going to happen in 1948, and that would have really blown their minds. Because that's what had happened. What they're not getting is he's not thinking historically. He's not thinking temporally. He's not thinking politically. Now, if you were them, wouldn't you want the Romans to be out of your hair? That's what they wanted. They were tired of being under Roman thumb. What we know is they were the guys, the Jewish religious guys, got in cahoots with the Romans to do what? To get Jesus crucified. They all played a part. And while the Jews were playing a part with the Romans more than anything in the world, they wanted to be out from under their control, but it just wasn't going to happen then. When Jesus would say things like, my kingdom is not of this world, they're just not getting it. Because they want his kingdom to be of this world. They want a reigning Messiah who's powerful, so powerful that he can get rid of this Roman authority and Roman power and just blow up the smithereens. That's what they're really saying. Can we become a sovereign state now? And Jesus said, that's the Father's business. He said, in fact, with this thing I'm talking about my kingdom, he says, seasons and times and all that, he said, that's not your business. Church, get that. That's not your business. That's not your business. Now, the problem in the church is that's what we've made our business. We've made temporal kingdoms of our own our business. Now hang with me here. That's why the church, when I talk about the church, I'm talking about the church universal right now. I'm talking about the church all over the place. I can spend hours documenting what I'm trying to say to you. Just hang with me with respect to the truth and what Jesus is talking about here in the book of Acts, because you'll never be the same. Because we've not understood as a church what this kingdom is all about, we have tried to create and build our own kingdoms. In the kingdom of this world, which James, if you've been in our James study on Wednesday nights in the big room, during our powerful living in the big room on Wednesday nights, if you've been in our James study, you know the wisdom of this world is what? It's pleasurable, it's sensual, and it's demonic. And when we're operating things, even within the church, according to the wisdom of this world, we're making decisions based on principles and wisdom that is earthy and sensual and demonic, and that's when things get out of control. Now hang with me here. Hang with me here. Better than that, hang with Jesus here. Because the kingdom of God is not the three things that we major on in America right now. This is the taproot of existentialism that I'm about to give you. First of all, the kingdom of God is not materialism. It's not materialism. Now just see if this is not America. Here's materialism in America today, which is rooted in existentialism, which is really a godless society, if you want to know the truth. Here's materialism. I deserve it. I want it. And I'll get it however I have to. Do you listen carefully to these commercials on television sometimes? I heard one the other day. It came to me the time I was preparing this study. And I remember when it came on, and they were trying to sell something, and what was the first word out of their mouth? You deserve this. I'm I'm thinking, that sounds really good. Now, my problem with that particular commercial was it wasn't something I wanted. So I didn't lose a fight there. Now, if it had been a new car, that might have been different. Hello? Materialism says, I deserve it, I want it, and I'll get it. That's America right now. That's not the kingdom of God. The kingdom of God is not materialism. The kingdom of God is not even individualism as we look at the words of Jesus and understand the church and the kingdom. Because individualism says, I work hard for what I get, you work hard for what you get, or what you want, I work hard for what I want, you work hard for what you want, I may get what I want, you may or may not get what you want, but that doesn't really matter to me. That's individualism. Which in the philosophy of existentialism leads to the survival of the fittest. I had a real estate guy tell me that the other day. And by what he said, I discovered how far he was from the kingdom. His bottom line to me was, it's going to be survival of the fittest in this economy we're in. I got news for you. It ain't even. When all the cards are played, those that are in the kingdom that we know are the ones that are going to win. Because somewhere in time, all this other stuff's going to be shaken out. And after the shaking is over, guess what, church? We're going to still be standing. I thought somebody might say hallelujah to that. Now stay with me, this gets better. The kingdom of God is not materialism. The kingdom of God is not individualism. And the kingdom of God is not skepticism. Skepticism within the framework of existentialism says, if I don't understand it, I don't have to worry about it if it doesn't apply to me. But if it does apply to me, somehow I will figure it out. Now think about how stupid that is. Has anybody here today figured out life outside of the context of a relationship with Jesus Christ? If you have, I'd like to get to know you. You're the smartest person I've ever known. Not. I talk with my buddy that coaches with the Dolphins a lot. They're going to be on tomorrow night on Monday night football. And I was talking to him the other day, and they've got this great wide receiver that just signed a $50 million contract. But let me tell you, does money make everybody happy? Does money give you what you want? Does money fix everything? You ain't talking about this guy. They've had to take one of the coaches out of the press box and put him on the sideline because he's the only guy that can deal with this guy's big ego. See, getting what you want doesn't help you get along with people. You see what I'm saying here? The kingdom of God is not about that kind of stuff. The kingdom of God is not materialism. It's not individualism. It's not skepticism. So what is the kingdom of God? Oh, it's in the book, Romans 14:17. Paul's dealing with the church at Rome. They've had a problem with criticism. Maybe somebody say to somebody else, based on what he says in the context of Romans 14, you know what, I know you're in the church at Rome there with me, and Paul started, remember I came to Christ, and you came to Christ, one old boys are talking to other things, and you know what, I was over at the steakhouse, the same steakhouse you were at the other night, and he said, I know for a fact that you paid me off of idols, I don't do that, and he's criticizing him because he did. Your steak had been offered to idols, my steak hadn't been offered to idols, I put it in modern day terminology, and Paul says, cut that stuff out. He says the kingdom of God is not about the areas where we disagree. In other words, the kingdom of God is not over disagreement of how we're going to do church. Or whether some of us are going to dance and some of us don't. Man, growing up as a Baptist boy in Texas, I didn't smoke, I didn't chew, I didn't go to the girls that knew. Because that's all I knew. I thought that's what a Christian was all about. And oh, my soul, when the church found out that my mom and dad were chaperones at the youth center for the Friday night dance after the high school football game, church. My uncle got kicked out of the Baptist church for playing his guitar in a barn dance. Now stay with me here, church. Paul says, that's not what the kingdom's about. See how the devil has had a heyday? So he says, what is the kingdom? The kingdom of God is peace and righteousness and joy of the Holy Spirit. You see how Paul turned the tune? See, we don't focus on these things that we don't necessarily agree on. I guarantee you, we could do a poll here this morning and everybody would have a different viewpoint about all these gray area things that we talk about in the Christian life. And Paul says, look, if you're focused on the kingdom, you don't even think about stuff like that, because things are peaceful, because you're living the good life. And when you come together, you experience the joy of the Holy Spirit because your focus is on the kingdom of God. My kingdom. Luke chapter 22. They're around the table. They're celebrating Passover. We know it is the Last Supper. Guess what's going on? Why I love the synoptic gospels. What one leaves out, the other one fills in. John was more concerned about presenting Jesus to the world as God. He leaves out some of these details, but Dr. Luke put them in there because Dr. Luke lets us know that in chapter 22, around that same table, where John talks about his focus is Jesus washing the disciples' feet, but when you read Luke's account, Dr. Luke, he says, yes, that happened. But he said, let me tell you what was going on before Jesus, the master servant, washed the disciples' feet. He said, there was controversy around the table. He had to deal with controversy around the Passover table. And the reason he had to was because there was a big debate going on as to who was going to be the greatest in the kingdom when he set it up. They're still thinking temporally, church. Stay with me. They're still thinking temporally. Who's going to be the greatest? Remember James and John? Their mother even gets involved. That one of my sons sitting on your right hand, one on the left, putting that in political and temporal application. She was saying, okay, you're going to be president of the kingdom. Let one of my sons be vice president, and let this other son of thunder be the secretary of state. Jesus said, I got a question. Can they drink the cup? What he was really saying was, can they endure the suffering that I'm going to be enduring? Our son used to wrestle. And his goal was not to be what? His goal was not to tap out. His goal was to get somebody else to tap out. In boxing, he called folding the towel. Jesus said, you know, that might be a consideration for one of them to be the vice president, one of them to be the secretary of state in my kingdom. He said, I just need to know something. Are they going to fold in the towel about halfway in the event? Because it's going to get real ugly. And then Jesus, as he corrects the situation, he said, now let me tell you, fellas, here's what's going to happen with my kingdom. I say with the church. He says, with my kingdom, kingdom I'm going to establish. Watch this. Prophetic. When I say what I'm about to say, I want you to think about who took the last time we took the Lord's Supper together, that been long ago. It's a picture of communion with Jesus, isn't it? He said, in my kingdom that I'm going to set up, he said, here's what you're going to get to do. He said, you're going to sit with me at my table.